Okay.
I'd like to welcome you today to our Beef and Forage Focus webinars. Again, these are a series of webinars that we hold usually on the first and third Tuesdays of the month. Today, it's actually the second Tuesday of the month, and we'll actually have one next week on August the 20th. But pleased to have with us today Dr. Galen Erickson, going to talk about pricing corn silage and some of the values, looking at that, especially as we look at current forage prices and also corn prices and how we might consider comparing that to other feed resources. Galen?
Okay, thanks for participating, and hopefully there's some interest in this, and especially as we're in getting closer to silage season. I think silage is a little bit delayed this year compared to last year, but it's certainly going to be upon us soon. I'm going to talk about some things related to pricing that I think is important and that we've been revisiting. I'm not trying to suggest that there aren't others out there that have similar tools and similar thoughts, but I want to take you through the logic we've used, especially here at the end, for pricing silage, because I think it's a little different than maybe what many people think, and it's probably been the area that we've gotten the most questions about. I think everybody knows, though, that using this residue is important to us, and certainly with drought in certain parts of the state and certainly across years, we want to use residue to the best of its ability and make it the best we can. You know, we've talked about stock grazing, but that's not a fit every place. And so then you get to harvesting residue. And so we've been focused on really researching all three of these areas: grazing residue, harvesting silage, and then baling residue if you don't have silage as an option. The good things about silage is that it offsets potential corn grain use because you get the grain with it. You also save, quote unquote, the good stuff that's in the residue at that time when you're harvesting that's frankly gone if you let it go to complete dry maturity. And we think it fits in a Nebraska system where we can recycle manure, potentially cover crops, et cetera, on corn silage acres. And so we think there's benefits actually of silage over baled stock residue. Doesn't mean we won't see baled stocks and baled residue, but silage we think even has greater benefits. Why is that? Well, again, relative to corn and dry stover, which is the alternative, is you could harvest the corn grain and then potentially use the dry stover. But if you use silage, you get the grain, plus you retain the solubles that are in the plant stalk and stem. You get high moisture corn, which is a great feed. Obviously, if prices are variable and you're not sure about inventory, using any of these types of feeds, but putting up corn silage essentially guarantees you're going to have feed and guarantees inventory. As mentioned, it fits in an integrated cattle and crop operation. Now, I have to admit that some of our interest in this over the last 2 years has been because historically, silage was a better option when grain prices got high. And so that's what renewed our interest, but I'm not sure that's a statement that's that important, because I think silage might be a good fit regardless of grain price, but we'll come back to that. If you have drought-damaged corn, it's a good way to use the residue. And we also think that there's should be some renewed interest in this because we think how it works today with feeding it in combination with byproducts, especially on finishing cattle, is an important topic. And again, some of that will be discussed next week. Okay, I want to first talk a little bit about drought-damaged silage before moving on to maybe more normal silage. Again, there was a lot of interest in this a year ago and a lot of silage harvested even by now across the state. Now, it's a good way to salvage acres. You got to worry about insurance and what your grain yield would be, but in some cases there could be little to no grain development in severe drought. Normally, we've always used a rule of thumb that silage is 50% grain, 50% forage at silage harvest. I'm going to adjust that some in my talk today. But the point is that with drought damage, that could be as little as no corn and all forage, all the way up to what would be more normal. You're going to see lower tonnage. Now, most of the times, especially last year when I was looking at harvested silage that was from drought acres, it was running 20 to 30% grain, and that was based on what the starch contents were, which I'm not sure is the best measure, but I don't know what's a better measure than that. Normal silage, you know, we assign a TDN or an energy value of normal silage of about 75. Just to put that in perspective, corn would be about 90. And drought damage silage, there's not a lot of tests on it, but Terry Mater did some work on it. And it's probably 70 to 90% as good as normal silage. And again, that's probably related to what the grain content would finally be. And so a TDN of 60 to 65 is probably, that's what's been observed anyway in previous tests. It'd be remiss not to discuss nitrate if we're talking about harvesting or salvaging drought-damaged acres. I think it's critical to target the correct dry matter for storage. I put a range of 32 to 40% for drought-damaged silage. Your risk is you can get it too dry very fast, and so if you're going to make use of those acres that are drought damaged, make sure it's wet enough to put up as silage. And then nitrates come up. And so nitrates can be confusing to many people. When you send it in for an analysis, you can get back the analysis and it might say nitrate nitrogen, or it might say just nitrate. And that shouldn't be too confusing, but if you get back nitrate nitrogen, that's the nitrogen part only. And you have to, it's a 4.4 multiplier to correct these nitrate numbers. So generally recognized values for nitrates, which again you can find in the literature and referenced in many extension publications, you know, you have to get up to probably well above 6,000 ppms before you probably need to worry much. And frankly, putting it up as silage will decrease the nitrate level some. And so we recommend, if you have any concerns, to get your silage tested for nitrate. It's a fairly inexpensive, quick test. There's probably few mycotoxins in those, but again, if there's a mycotoxin concern, you should test for that. Feedlot cattle are a great use for concerned silage. They're the least sensitive to it. There's a host of mycotoxins to test for, but you do want to be cautious when feeding cows or breeding animals. I think many people are aware and should be aware of the excellent webinar that Dr. Bolson did in mid-July. I want to reiterate or highlight a few of his comments and then maybe add to that and then move on to some of our work on when to harvest and a little bit on storage and then how this changes over time and how to price it. Again, just to reiterate, next week we'll talk about the value in growing and finishing diets. So in Dr. Bolson's webinar, a few things I took away from that is that average shrink is estimated to be 20% is what he mentioned, and we think that that can be improved, and I agree with that statement he made. Target density of 16 pounds of dry matter per cubic foot is really what producers need to target, and that was only an average of 14.5 pounds of dry matter in a survey from Wisconsin in 1997. So again, how we pack this in bunker silos is pretty important. He mentioned targeting a 5-inch packing layer thickness, which, again, I think is excellent advice. I don't spend a lot of time talking about those things, and I really paid attention to that. And cover piles really helps with shrink. And I want to reiterate, he emphasized safety, and that's something we don't want to take for granted, and I'll mention again at the end. Okay, now a little bit more about shrink. I wanted to delve into that a little bit more than maybe was covered before. There's two consequences of producers ignoring shrink losses. One is you'll run out of silage because you won't put up enough, or you'll undercharge what the real cost of silage is to the cattle. And I've got an example here. If you estimate the best way to measure shrink is to, well, first off, the best thing is to measure shrink, but for sure you need to at least estimate it, but I would always recommend measuring it. It's tough to do. My definition of shrink is basically anything the difference between what you got delivered versus what you got fed to the cattle. And then you divide that by how much was delivered, and that gives you a percent shrink or loss. Now, that's not just loss like many people think. There are other things that can contribute to that, which I'll get to. But as an example, if you have an operation and you need 10,000 tons of silage as is, and you have a 15% shrink, you need to take 10,000 and divide it by 0.85, or the cost and divide it by 0.85 to account for shrink. For example, 10,000 divided by 0.85 is equal to 11,765 tons. So if you need to feed 10,000 tons of silage, you need to put up 11,765 tons in the bunker. Likewise, if that cost is $50 per ton in the bunker, by the time you get it fed, the cost is actually 50 divided by 0.85, or almost $59. And just for that 10,000 ton operation, that equates to over $88,000 of loss, quote unquote loss, as shrink. So what do I consider shrink? Well, clearly most people think about it as being fermentation losses and spoilage losses, and those are true, and those are big parts. There are some other things, though, that operations can still control. One is they didn't accurately account for dry matter. And so maybe they're feeding something that's drier and they didn't accurately get it done, and it's going to mess them up when it comes to shrink. The other thing is that these fermented feeds like silage have volatiles, which many times are not measured accurately in dry matters, and we'll come back to that briefly. If your scales are inaccurate, you're not feeding, and you really don't have a clue what your shrink is. And so if you've never had your scales checked, we recommend at least once a year, twice a year if you're a feeding operation. If you're a producer and you're not accurately weighing it out, or your feed folks are not accurately weighing it out, both into the bunkers, out of the bunker, and feeding it in the bunk, then that's a problem. Wind losses are probably low for silages. Those would be bigger issues for dry forages. Varmints, if you have problems with that and they're consuming your feed, that's a loss. And then if you do have a lot of spoilage and you have to discard, that's a problem. One thing I want to mention about dry matters, and we need to do some more work on this, in my opinion. But, for example, there was some older work that suggested that you could lose 5.6 to almost 10% when you do dry matters if you do them in the ovens. And that's really a challenge, because those volatiles likely got to the cattle, and so we will probably mess up what our performance values are in terms of feed efficiency. You actually fed more silage than what you thought, and may change what your performance, what you attribute to performance from silage. However, I want to point out that at the end here, I'm going to talk some about pricing silage. If you don't have this dry matter quite right, but you've accounted for it as shrink, then it doesn't change the economics and the final result. Okay, so Pioneer and many companies are interested in silage, and many companies have inoculants, and they talk about when to harvest. These are some slides that I've used that are originally from Pioneer. Milk line can be used as a sign of when to harvest silage. The old suggestions were half to two-thirds milk line if you're in a bunker, two-thirds milk line to black layer and uprights. I'm going to challenge that some today, but generally those are also associated with moistures, and so that would be 65 to 72% moisture with the bunkers. Uprights, you can be a little drier. Again, I want to challenge that some today. And some people may disagree with me, but I think we need to work on that as a research community and an extension. So when should you harvest silage? Well, we've been doing some work on this, and black layer is 100% mature and essentially ensures no grain loss. Many people are worried, though, that it gets too dry by then, and we can discuss that if there's questions. But if you take it at half or two-thirds milk line, then that suggests that there will be some loss. It may be quite small, but there will be some loss of potential plant yield and grain yield. 35% dry matter has been the target historically in the norm. And I guess my question is, should we be worried about dry matter, or should we be worried about black layer? If we go to the black layer and have 40% dry matter, does it matter? And I the data that I can find, which I'm open if anybody knows of others, that I haven't found, but the data suggests that up to 40% is okay in terms of storage, but I'm worried about packing density, which has not been well measured, and shrink that's not been well measured. So that's why I think we need to refocus some on what the impact of dry matter is on those two issues. My recommendation is that the one day after black layer is established, which is hopefully equivalent to 35 to 36% dry matter, you cut silage. That's hard to do in large operations, and it's hard to get that just perfect, which I understand. Clearly, there was some discussion that Dr. Bolson had, and others know a lot more about this. I just want to reiterate, you got to get this packed. It's got to ferment well. There's a lot of debate about inoculants and using those and what the impact is on storage losses, and then it's got to be covered. You want to minimize exposed surface, and you want to feed off 6 inches a day and keep the loose material fed up, and again, be safe about how you're managing that bunker. Okay, I want to then switch to two things here in the last half of this, and that is primarily focused on how does this change when you get to the end of the growing season and get to silage harvest time? How are the plants changing? And then a little bit on pricing silage. Clearly, corn silage production has to accomplish, you got to have good silage yields. We want to have as good of nutrition in that silage as possible. But frankly, we want to have the flexibility so that producers could let that corn go to grain harvest and have no grain yield compromised either. And so that's asking quite a bit. So what we've been thinking about and working on is some on corn hybrids and planting densities in cooperation with agronomy and horticulture here at UNL, and looking at how does this change over time, especially when you get down to as that plant's maturing. We have 2 years of data at UNL. I want to certainly reference Wisconsin has got many, many years of data, very good data on how this change is occurring at the end of the growing season, but they didn't look at it quite the same way we did, and so I want to reference that there's a lot of data in Wisconsin on silage and how it's changing over time and across hybrids. So these were some plots near York, Nebraska, irrigated ground. Tom Hogemeyer was involved. It was, again, agronomy plot project, but we were able to go in and harvest some times. That was the custom harvest crew that the PhD student had. So essentially there's three harvest times. The dates aren't important. It was somewhat based on when silage harvest would normally occur, and then 2 weeks later, and then the last harvest time was right before dry grain harvest. There was moderately early maturing hybrids and moderately late maturing hybrids. And I just listed the dry matters, at least for year one. What they were on September 1st was 38 and 35. For the first harvest, again, this would probably be normal silage time. In the low 40s 2 weeks later, and then obviously dry grain harvest out here, but we still harvested the whole plant. Now, again, I don't want to focus on this too much because this wasn't our focus, but the part of these plots had different planting densities with plants per acre, which, again, there's a lot of interest in that in the agronomic community. You can see what the impact was on grain yield. It's quadratic. So you get a benefit up to more plants from the first level, and then it sort of levels off. Dry matter yields, very similar. The percent grain, which we've measured, this is across all three harvest times. So this is not that useful as itself, but it wasn't impacted dramatically, although it was quadratic. But the very small differences, and then you can see the TDN values as planting density was influenced. I show that just so you have it for information. Our focus was mostly on what's the impact of harvest time. So again, remember, this harvest one would have been about the time of normal silage, a couple weeks later for harvest two, and then dry grain harvest. Now, again, this is across a lot of hybrids and across those planting densities. But dry matter yield, and this is total dry matter yield of the plant and the grain, was 11 tons of dry matter per acre to to 12 and then back down to 10. And I'm intrigued by this drop off from harvest 2 to 3. Grain percentage was about 51, went up to 52, and then it jumps up quite dramatically into the low 60s. And that's what we see happening as we, as this plant matures, the proportion of grain in the plant obviously increases because that stays about the same. It's the residue that's decreasing in terms of amount. To illustrate that graphically, this is looking at the TDN in tons per acre. The green part is the forage component. The yellow part would be the grain that contributes that TDN tonnage per acre. Notice that overall TDN increased from the first harvest to the second one, and that was a function of a little bit on the forage and a little bit on the grain. And then it drops off on the normal harvest of grain, and that's primarily a loss in the TDN of the plant component. So that's what we mean when we say that the plant, the best time to harvest the forage that's in the plant is not at dry grain harvest. It's before that and at silage time, or even maybe a little later than normal silage time. We harvested 15% less TDN, and that's got some real economic values with today's prices on energy. Okay, hopefully there'll be some questions about that. If there are, I'd be happy to talk about them. The thing I want to focus on here now at the end, in my last five or six slides, are really on taking us through a process we've used on pricing silage. We've not spent a lot of time and a lot of history on this, and I know there's others that have pricing calculators available, but we want to look at it with custom harvest rates here in Nebraska, et cetera. So I want to take you through an example. The first thing we want to start with is what's the value of the grain in the field, regardless of whether you harvest it for silage or not, okay? So we just use some good irrigated acres, an assumed 200 bushels per acre yield, which is 4.8 tons per acre of dry matter as grain yield. At $5 a bushel and 200 bushels, that's $210 per ton of dry matter, and $1,000 per acre. Okay, so $5 per bushel on a dry matter cost for the grain is $210. If the silage is 52% grain, 48% forage, and you harvested 200 bushels of grain, you should get almost 9.2 tons of silage dry matter. Now again, that's why these numbers are important, and ultimately this silage yield is important. But if that holds true, and that might be the only weakest point in my summary here, but if that holds true, then the grain's $1,000 an acre, and so the grain in that silage is $1,000 divided by 9.2 tons, gives you almost $110 per ton of dry matter. In that silage, that's what the grain's contributing. And that's what we think the value of the silage is going to be dictated by. So at 35% dry matter, it's $38 per ton as is. Now, there's a whole lot of numbers there, but here's the point. 200 bushels per acre, $5 per bushel corn, gives you a silage value of $109 per ton of dry matter. On an as-is basis, that silage is $38.24. Now, what everybody wants to do is they want to have a calculation of, okay, what do I take corn price times to get to my silage price. So if you do that, the as-is silage price of $38.24 per ton as-is divided by the as-is bushel price of corn, which is the 5, gives you a multiplier of 7.65. So if someone asked me what's the value of silage in the field, I would say it's 7.65 times grain price. Now, does that hold true if corn's not $5? And actually it does. If you change the same example and use $3 per bushel, you go through all the math. Now instead of $1,000 per acre, it's $600. You come up with a different silage value of almost $23 per ton. But this 22.94, which is the as-is per ton price of silage, and the $3 per bushel price as-is of corn, gives you a multiplier still of 7.65. It is not impacted. Using this logic and this pricing mechanism, the multipliers not impacted by grain price. Now, that's the first step, and that's lower than what most people think, and that's the part I want to make sure everybody understands what our logic was. Now, there's other factors you got to account for, and this is another part I think many people have somewhat neglected. If you're going to cut harvest, or if you're going to cut silage, you're not going to harvest grain. And there's a cost to harvesting grain. And so the benefit of cutting silage is that you don't have grain harvest. Well, what is that cost? Well, and based on a survey from our Ag Econ department, I think it was Johnson and others, 2012 custom harvest rate in Nebraska averaged across the state was $31.77 per acre. If you again back calculate that on a per ton of silage basis for my 200 bushel per acre example, that comes out to be $1.20 per ton of silage as is, or $3.50 per ton of dry matter. That's a benefit to the silage because you don't have to cut silage. Another benefit is that when you harvest corn grain, you've got to haul it somewhere to sell it. You don't sell it at the field fence. And again, average cost in Nebraska was estimated to be 11 cents per bushel. My example we were using before was 2,200 bushel per acre, so that's $22 per acre. Those are savings that you get by cutting silage instead of harvesting grain. Now, there are costs of the silage. The first one that everybody says is, well, we're taking all that residue off, and there's a value to that residue. And I agree. So if you look at what average residue content is for many of the nutrients that we're worried about for crop production, if you add in all of the NPK, sulfur, and calcium, it's $90 per acre. Now, most people generally don't worry about the potassium, sulfur, and calcium here, because especially in a manure situation. But if you just look at nitrogen and phosphorus, which probably have the biggest concern of taking it off, that's almost $50 per acre. So there's no doubt that when you cut silage, you're removing $50 per acre of nutrients in that residue. Now, recall that I saved about $54 by cutting silage instead of harvesting corn. So we're not trying to be smart about it, but those are roughly equal and they offset each other. Plus, in the situations that we're talking about here in Nebraska, we expect that if you're going to cut silage, that operation is a great place to use manure on those acres and replenish those nutrients. But by the way, I didn't give you any benefit to using the manure. So if you really want to get down to it, we should have a plus on the cattle operation of replenishing those nutrients with manure. So my point is that we're going to say that roughly taking the value of the residue off is offset by the cost of harvesting grain, and that we did not give any benefit to the cattle operation of using manure. Okay. Now, that's just for it in the field and the consequences of silage instead of grain. Now, so as I alluded to, we think that for the silage value in the field standing is 7.65 times the price of corn. So what does it cost to get it chopped, hauled, and packed? Again, using custom rates, which are published for 2012, and people can argue with that if they want, but those are the only data we have. To get that chopped, hauled, and packed was $8.13 per ton as is of silage, or $23 per ton of dry matter if it's $35 per ton of, or 35% dry matter. So this is a cost of silage that has to go towards the silage that's priced to the cattle. And then, frankly, there's a cost of it when it's being stored in a bunker. We base this on what I alluded to earlier and Dr. Brolson referenced, was that on average, how much are we packing into bunkers? So I used that Wisconsin survey. And then if you use some depreciated costs of bunkers, again, we can debate what those were, but we estimate that that's about $2 per ton of silage as is, or about $5.50 per ton of dry matter. So there's some extra costs of silage taking it from the field and getting it stored in the bunker. So to summarize and put these back onto a factor of corn price, if you look at silage in the field, it's 7.65 times corn bushel price, as is. So as is tonnage price of silage at 35 dry matter is 7.65 times as is bushel price of corn. If you look at $3 per bushel corn, it's 11 times $3 by the time you get it into the bunker and in storage. And then if you have a shrink loss, you have to add that in, which we've done, and it gets to 12.2 times corn price by the time you get it delivered to the cattle. And so what many people said, well, we've been publishing 11 times price of corn, and now I said it was 7.65. Well, it depends on whether it's in the field, in the bunker, or in the bunk at the cattle delivered to them, which price you should use. At $6 corn, now at $6 corn, notice the 7.65 didn't change. But it does influence quite a bit what the price is of the silage in the bunker, 9.3 times corn price, and what it is at the bunk. And so the other thing I want to caution you on is that when corn was $7 a bushel, I was saying that silage shouldn't be more than nine times the price of corn in the bunker. And everybody said, well, that's crazy. Well, that's because they were using math when corn was cheaper, and they were assuming shrink on it before it left the bunker. And I'm assigning that shrink at the time it goes to the bunk. So I think we're all on the same page, but I think it depends a lot on how people look at where you're pricing the silage in terms of where it's at in this operation. That's our best logic, I guess, and open to feedback and input on that. Okay, so then just to wrap up, as Dr. Bolson said, think about safety around these bunkers, safety first, and I agree with that, and we take that for granted too often. I would certainly recommend producers measure and monitor their shrink. It's hard to measure, but they need to try, and you need to account for it in terms of how much you put up and also what the cost is. As I mentioned, for a 10,000-ton silage operation, that can be $80,000 if you don't account for shrink. When we harvest this grain, I think is important, this corn silage, and I think we need more work on this. Our current estimates are is that at silage time, it's 52% grain, 48% forage. I have to point out that in those plots that we harvested, that was 6-inch stubble height, and it's probably 10-inch when we harvest in fields. And so we need to adjust that potentially in field harvest situations. But it's 62% grain under the same situation at normal grain harvest. The other thing I would mention, and we'll get into next week, is that there's only 55% as much residue TDN if you bale the stalks versus harvest it at silage time. So we lose a lot of TDN if we don't harvest it at silage and we let it go to stalks. There's a place for using stalks, but I think if you can use silage, it's a much better use of the residue. Just to reiterate, price in the field, 7.65 times corn price, regardless of what the price of corn does, and then it's very much influenced from that point on by the price of corn and jumps quite a bit by the time you get it to the bunk. Aaron, with that, I would turn it over to questions. I've been watching the chat box. I don't see any. This is just a diagram showing some of the logic we're going through for our integrated crop cattle system here in Nebraska, recycling that manure back on the silage acres. Again, we did not account for that in our current economics. We'll try and Aaron and I have talked about getting that logic or that spreadsheet that we've been developing that's got maybe our logic on it that I've gone through here online, and we'll try and do that. Any questions?
I see Dr. Bolson is typing one in for you. So I'd remind you that today's webinar will be archived at the beef.unl.edu website under webinars if you'd like to go back and watch that in the future. And then please plan to join us next week when Galen will give the second part addressing corn silage use and its feeding to both forage-focused diets and also finishing diets. Well, Dr. Erickson, I don't see any other questions in, so I think we'll probably wrap it up for today.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks.